Together worship. It's great to be with you here this day. I hope this finds you well. Hopefully you have the liturgy in front of you. Thank you to all of those that have contributed to this service to make this possible this day. It is greatly appreciated by myself and by Elvin and by so many other people that join in. Thank you for all that you do. So let's have a moment of quiet as we recognise that we are in Almighty God's presence. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let everything be said and done in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God through Jesus Christ. Sing psalms, hymns, and sacred songs. Let us sing to God with thankful hearts. Open our lips, O Lord, and we shall praise your name.
Thank you.
We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. Jesus said, "Before you offer your gift, go and be reconciled." As brothers and sisters in God's family, we come together to ask our Father for forgiveness. We say together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore to us the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song will we praise our God. Blessed are you, Lord our God, Creator and Redeemer of all. To you be glory and praise forever. From the waters of chaos you drew forth the world, and in your great love fashioned us in your image. Now through the deep waters of death, you have brought your people to new birth by raising your Son to life in triumph. May Christ your light ever dawn in our hearts as we offer you our sacrifice of thanks and praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. The night has passed and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. And the collect for today, the 10th Sunday after Trinity. Lord of heaven and earth, as Jesus taught his disciples to be persistent in prayer, give us patience and courage never to lose hope, but always to bring our prayers before you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Just as you were once disobedient to God, but have now received mercy because of their disobedience, so they have now been disobedient in order that, by the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God has imprisoned all in disobedience so that he may be merciful to you to all.
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Psalm 133. How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity.
It is like the precious oil poured on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down upon the collar of his robes.
It is as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion, for there the Lord bestows his blessing. Even life forevermore.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Then Jesus called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into a person's mouth that makes him ritually unclean. Rather, what comes out of it makes him unclean. Then the disciples came to him and said, Do you know that the Pharisees had their feelings hurt by what you said? Every plant which my Father in heaven did not plant will be pulled up, answered Jesus. Don't worry about them. They are blind leaders of the blind, and when one blind man leads another, both fall into a ditch. Peter spoke up. Explain this saying to us. Jesus said to them, You are still no more intelligent than the others. Don't you understand? Anything that goes into a person's mouth goes into his stomach, and then on out of his body. But the things that come out of the mouth come from the heart, and these are the things that make a person ritually unclean. For from his heart come the evil ideas which lead him to kill, commit adultery, and do other immoral things, to rob, lie, and slander others. These are the things that make a person unclean. But to eat without washing your hands, as they say you should, this doesn't make a person unclean. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This morning, I want to begin by telling you about a time before I became a priest, when I was a Weight Watchers leader. I had a number of meetings, and a lot of them were in church halls. As a leader, I carried all the stock in my car, and my volunteer helpers would meet me at the venue and then help me unpack and set up. I carried an awful lot of stuff, and some of it was really heavy. And so I would try and park as close as I could to the door of the venue. I took over a meeting in a church that was in the centre of a town, and so parking was really difficult. Around the back of the church, there was a small car park and a designated minister's parking space. Because parking was difficult, the only usual spot the last few weeks that I had been doing the class was this designated minister's spot. I had been happily parking there, as I thought the minister wouldn't need it. There's only a Weight Watchers class going on in the church, and on a Thursday night, I thought there were no services going on that I was aware of. Well, the evening in question, I had parked up and was beginning to unload my car, my helpers all around me, when a loud voice shouted, "You can't park there!" I can't remember the exact conversation, but the two ladies who'd shouted out were clearly very protective over this spot that wasn't being used. So much so that they were really quite rude and abusive. I have to say that I was shocked and embarrassed for them. These were two supposedly Christian women in front of a group of non-Christians acting in such a way that to say they were being unwelcoming is an understatement. All that was going through my mind was, what would these non-Christians think? You see, nothing makes me more cross than Christians behaving badly. When Christians behave badly to each other, and even worse, when they behave badly to or in front of other Christians. We should be setting an example that draws people in, not one that repels. In the Matthew reading, Jesus is talking about being clean on the inside as being what truly counts. It's not the rituals that make a person pure. The rituals for purity in themselves weren't wrong, even though they had developed over the years with extra traditions and rules way past the original rites. But Jesus was saying that just relying on a ritual to make you clean is not enough. It is important to be pure through and through, not just on the outside. Jesus pointed out that it isn't what goes into the mouth that makes a person unclean, but what comes out of it. This would have had a big impact on his hearers. They were used to avoiding certain foods, circumstances, and even people who would make them unclean. To actually eat something that was considered dirty would have been abhorrent to them. So to suggest that eating something they thought would defile them and it not mattering was deeply shocking. Not only that, but what did Jesus mean exactly by what comes out? Well, perhaps having had many a Bible study, we know that Jesus is talking about our words and our actions. Jesus was saying that it is what someone says that reveals the true nature of a person, their deep down purity of heart. Psychologists know that people reveal what is really going on inside of them by what they say in unguarded moments, when people aren't concentrating or think no one of consequence is watching. We can see that playing out over social media, where internet trolls write horrible, abusive, rude and racist things, knowing that they have a level of anonymity that protects them. Would the ladies have behaved that way in front of other members of their congregation, I wonder? Would they have shouted at me in front of their minister? In this account, Jesus was saying that it's our words and actions that make someone unclean, unfit for God's holy presence. It's quite a long list: adultery, theft, false witness, blasphemy, and more. The motivations behind these actions are given away in the thoughts and words that rise up from the depths of the heart. It doesn't matter what purity codes people keep, it's the innermost self that needs to be changed if we are to be what God intended and wants us to be. The discussion here in this passage isn't about whether Jesus and his followers keep the traditions that the Pharisees had been maintaining and trying to push on the other Jews. The discussion is about what God wants his people to be like. Jesus is answering the question, the deep desire that so many, including the Pharisees, were desperate to know. How can the human heart be made pure? Jesus is pointing out that relying on traditions and laws is not enough. It is easy for someone to keep to all the stipulations, yet be untouched and unchanged deep down. The list starts quite drastically with murder, but as it goes on, we can read that there are quite a few things that most of us could be considered capable of. Even the small, unguarded words or actions we perform every day matter and have an effect. That casual, throwaway comment reveals something about the heart, and it matters. A ritual cleansing of the body is not enough. Jesus likens it to one blind person trying to lead another. Our challenge as followers of Jesus is to focus on what's going on deep down inside our hearts. We don't have purity rites, but we do have our traditions and unsaid expectations that we put on ourselves and each other. It's easy to attend church and think that that's enough, to think that being on all the rotas will keep us right with God, to think that our weekly offering is an entrance fee to church or even into heaven, or to think that owning a Bible will be enough to make us pure. I could go on. Now, don't get me wrong. All these things are indeed good, but they should be the result of a heart turned to God, not as a means to make us pure. They are the symptoms of a pure heart, not its cure. If the heart is cured of its impurity, then the symptoms will be shown in our words and actions. We will reveal what is deep down that is really going on in our hearts. Now, I'm not saying these ladies that shouted at me didn't have pure hearts. I can't make that judgment. In fact, I shouldn't make that judgment. Only God can do that. But their actions had repercussions that have echoed out, so that even now, some 15 years or more later, I remember them. I don't remember the words, but I remember how they made me feel. We may think the odd times we reveal our true natures accidentally don't have an impact, but they do. What is the cure for the human heart? How do we then, if our actions aren't enough to purify ourselves, what can be done? Well, Jesus, in this case, is the answer. Ultimately, he himself is the cure. It is through his death and resurrection and the gift of the Spirit that the wickedness and uncleanliness that affects every human heart is dealt with. But the cure has to be applied deep down. We have to open every dark corner of our hearts. We have to let it spread out into every part of our souls. So that when we stand before God, we will be as he intended us to be, pure through and through. Amen.
That drown the tender.
Conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord our God. You are our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. We seek to put our trust in you and to do your will, that your kingdom may come in us, as it is in heaven. Blessed are you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Lord God, help us to build our lives on a firm foundation, to put our trust in you and your saving love. Strengthen your church when it is beset by the storms of the world, that it may remain firm in the faith and obedient to you. We pray for all who are seekers, looking for meaning and purpose in their lives and in the world. We remember all who are being persecuted for their faith. Ask your blessing upon all who teach and influence others, upon those who set standards and offer ways of living to our society. We pray for all who are involved in government, in broadcasting, and in the press. We remember all whose lives have been caught up in floods, famine, or war. All who feel fragile and endangered. We pray for all who help others to rebuild their lives. We give thanks for those who have provided us with security and protection. We ask your blessing upon our homes and our loved ones. We pray for the places where we work and for those with whom we spend our leisure time. We remember all homeless and stateless people. We bring before you all whose world has fallen apart this week. We remember those who have lost loved ones, who have lost freedom, employment, or who have had their homes repossessed. We pray for all who have been involved in accidents, or who have suddenly become ill. We ask your blessing upon those who are close to death. Ask your blessing upon our loved ones who have departed from us, passing through that great flood we call death. May they rejoice in your welcome and in your kingdom. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. now going to use the offertory prayer, which we use every week in our services within the buildings, but we've not used actually on our online services. This is really, I think this is really important to use, because many of you have continued to give financially for the upkeep of the churches, and that's been gratefully received and really, really important going forward. We don't pay an entrance fee. We give things back to God, which he's given us in our lives, but also in our money. So let's say this prayer together.
Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you.
Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those whom you love, now and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen.
I be a